The Gospel according to Luke, chapter 1, verses 5 through 25. In the days of King Herod of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah, who belonged to the priestly order of Abijah. His wife was a descendant of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Both of them were righteous before God, living blamelessly according to all the commandments and regulations of the Lord. But they had no children, because Elizabeth was barren, and both were getting on in years. Once, when Zechariah was serving as priest before God, and his section was on duty, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to enter the sanctuary of the Lord and to offer incense. Now at the time of the incense offering, the whole assembly of the people was praying outside. Then there appeared to him an angel of the Lord, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw the angel, he was terrified, and fear overwhelmed him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard. Your wife, Elizabeth, will bear you a son, and you will name him John. You will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He must never drink wine or strong drink. Even before his birth, he will be filled by the Holy Spirit. He will turn many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God. With the spirit and power of Elijah, he will go before him to turn the hearts of parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah said to the angel, "How will I know that this is so? For I am an old man, and my wife is getting on in years." The angel replied, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. But now, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time, you will become mute, unable to speak until the day that these things occur." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondered at his delay in the sanctuary. When he did come out, he could not speak to them, and they realized that he had seen a vision in the sanctuary. He kept motioning to them and remained unable to speak. When his time of service was ended, he went to his home. After those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she remained in seclusion. She said, "This is what the Lord has done for me, when he looked favorably on me and took away the disgrace I had endured among my people."
October, and Halloween hasn't even happened yet, and you see
But Christmas decorations and advertisements are already up. Do you ever just want to stand up and shout like Charlie Brown? Is there anyone who knows what Christmas is all about? I'm sure you've seen the classic TV special, A Charlie Brown Christmas. It's been airing every year since 1965. That's a pretty good run as TV shows go. Especially for a cartoon that was produced on a low budget and a last-minute production schedule. The creator of the Peanuts cartoons, Charles Schulz, he threw together the outline for that show in a day. And the producers, they agreed to it. They agreed to it even though Schulz had some pretty unorthodox ideas for the Charlie Brown Christmas. Ideas like giving the show a jazz soundtrack, and no laugh track, which was a staple of TV shows in that era. Most of all, Charles Schulz was adamant that the true story of Christmas be presented, complete with a scene read straight from the Bible. Even back then, even back in 1965, the TV producers were worried that it would be too controversial to read from the Bible on national TV. But Schulz insisted. And you are probably all familiar with that scene. Young and old alike, I'm sure you've seen it. Charlie Brown is surrounded by all the trappings of Christmas. There's the lights and the trees and the music, but they just aren't putting old Chuck into a Christmas spirit. And when he wonders aloud what Christmas is really all about, his friend Linus sets him straight with a clear answer, straight from the Gospel according to Luke. Linus recites the passage in one of the most poignant scenes in television history. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. In those words, Charlie Brown finds hope. He goes from feeling depressed by the season to feeling inspired by it. He goes from an inward focus of questioning to an outward focus of sharing the hope, the love, the joy, and the peace of that season with others. Today, as we start this Advent sermon series, I invite you to hear those same words of hope as we enter the season of Advent and expectation of Christmas. Over the next 4 weeks, we'll unwrap the gifts of Christmas as we journey through the Advent season. It's our chance to listen to the stories, to remember the true meaning of Christmas, to wait in expectation for the arrival of Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. The point of this focus is not to get rid of the trappings and traditions and celebrations all around us, but rather it is to take a purposeful journey through them in order to experience more deeply those gifts of Christmas, hope, love, joy, and peace. So what exactly is Advent? I mean, for some of you, this concept might be new. I did not grow up in a liturgical church. So we didn't celebrate Advent. We didn't have the Advent wreath. And when I was a kid, the only thing that I knew about Advent was that my grandma New Year would give me a little calendar with windows that contained a piece of chocolate for each day of the month leading up to Christmas. That's what I knew about Advent. But Advent is so much more. As we celebrate Advent by lighting the candles of our Advent wreath this season, we will light a new additional candle each week, one for hope one for love, one for joy, and one for peace. Each flame brings us closer to the arrival of the true light of the world, Jesus Christ. The word Advent, it means coming or arrival, and the season is marked by expectation, waiting, anticipation, and longing. Advent is not just the prelude to Christmas. It is a season that links the past, the present, and the future together. Advent, it offers us the opportunity to share in that historical, ancient longing for the coming of the Messiah, to celebrate his birth, but also to look forward to his second coming. Advent looks back upon Christ being born in Bethlehem, while at the same time it looks forward with eager anticipation to the day when Christ's kingdom shall be completed on earth. Advent, then, is about hope. Hope already fulfilled in the birth, the life, the death, and resurrection of Christ, and also hope for God's future that is still waiting to be completed. In a season often marked by frenzied busyness, Advent is an opportunity to set aside time to prepare our hearts and help us to place our focus on the bigger picture, the story of God's redeeming love for the world. Advent is a season of digging deep into what it means for us that God himself came to the earth in human form. It's a season of expectation and preparation, an opportunity to align ourselves with God's presence rather than focusing on our Christmas presents. So wherever you are on your own spiritual journey, I invite you into this season. It's a time that allows for questions and for doubts and struggles as we take time to prepare for Christ's coming. Advent is a celebration that God comes. God comes to us into the darkness, into the pain, into the chaos. God comes into our world. God finds a way. As we unwrap each gift of Christmas over the next few weeks, my hope is that we will discover together that we can trust in Emmanuel, in God with us. He is bigger than our greatest expectations or our deepest fears. His light shines in the darkness to help us find a way. So this first Sunday in Advent, we focus on hope. Let's start by looking at what we mean by hope. I mean, what statements do you typically hear people make that involve that word hope? If you're going out for a picnic, maybe it's, "I hope it doesn't rain today." If you look around right now, say, "I hope it rains soon. I hope I get the job. I hope this is the winning lottery ticket. I'm going to ask her out on a date, and I hope she says yes. I had my wisdom teeth removed on Friday. A number of people told me, I hope everything goes well." Do you notice a theme there? Usually when we use the word hope, it's characterized by doubt, uncertainty, and a lack of control, right? In other words, we hope for things that we want to happen, but which may or may not happen. We don't know for sure what will happen. We don't have any control over what will happen, but we are hoping for a particular outcome. But in Jesus Christ, the outcome is guaranteed. The hope of Christian faith is a guarantee, a sure thing. Our hope is actually a know-so rather than a hope-so. The Old Testament is full of prophecies about this Messiah. A well-known prophecy from Isaiah promises, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace." These and other prophecies gave a clear expectation of God's promised Messiah. Hundreds of years before the arrival of the Messiah, God promised that a Messiah would come. But of course, those promises, They didn't always make the waiting easy. As we prepare for Jesus' coming this Christmas, we share in the waiting of the people of Israel. Like them, most of us have situations and circumstances in our lives that make it difficult to wait on God. And like them, we are still waiting for the completion of God's salvation of the world. I mean, yes, it's true, many prophecies will be fulfilled with the birth and the death and the resurrection of Jesus, but many others of God's promises are yet to be completed. As you sit here this morning, the present hope that you hold on to, it might not seem to be changing things. Certainly, it might not seem to be changing things fast enough. Your heart and mind might be flooded with the concerns and stresses and hardships that you face. Any signs of change in your circumstances might be slim to none. But that doesn't mean that change isn't happening. It doesn't mean that God isn't working behind the scenes, inside other people or situations. Whatever it might look like on the outside, God is working on the inside, working in our hearts and working in our world to teach us and to shape us. Regardless of what outward results look like in any given moment, we can find hope in the words of Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19. It says, we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. Our present hope in Jesus, it doesn't mean that there will no longer be any storms in life. It doesn't change the immediate situations we face. But like an anchor that holds a ship steady against the wind and the waves and the storms, our hope holds us firm and secure in the midst of life's storms. Let this season be one of secure hope in the midst of whatever storms you face. So what can purposeful waiting this Advent season do for us? As we look back on the biblical stories of those people who trusted in God and how their hopes were fulfilled, we gain confidence and we renew our faith in God's promises to us. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about the things we cannot see. It's hard to be patient, and it's hard to wait. But I encourage you to lean on God's promises and unwrap the gift of hope today. No matter what the department stores tell you, Christmas has not arrived yet. This is Advent, a season of preparation, waiting, and expectation. There is a spiritual discipline as well as excitement that comes with waiting and hoping. May this be a season of wonder as you discover all the gifts that Jesus offers this Christmas. Hope, love, joy, and peace. Amen.